This lecture is the continuity of our lecture series on Pakistan studies for IGCSE, GCEO level students and CSS candidates. In this lecture, we are going to have a review of different political events held in India from 1927 to 1930. So important events that we are going to cover today, one is Simon Commission, Nehru Report, 14 points of Mr. Jinnah and its importance, Allahabad Address, and the Roundtable Conference. Three sessions. My dear students and viewers, the year from 1927 to 1930 actually are very important in the history of India and Pakistan. The events that I have already enumerated, they played an important role in the determination of the status of All Indian National Congress and All India Muslim League as the representatives of the two communities, Hindus and Muslims, respectively. The communalism began to usher in the history of India again at the end of the Khilafat movement. The historical period of Indo-Muslim unity came to an end after Khilafat movement. The misunderstandings between the Muslim leadership and the Congress leadership had already emerged when Gandhi called off the movement. In England, the fresh elections were expected before 1929. The British government had promised to the Indians that the next installment of the political and constitutional reforms would be implemented and given to Indians in 1929. It was due in 1929, the British government would bring new reforms. Before passing the new reforms and enacting as a law of India in 1929, the government of Conservative Party in England decided to send a mission in India under the leadership of Sir John Simon. Let's start from this now, Simon Commission. The Conservative Party government sent commission under the leadership of John Simon in 1927. The purpose of John Simon was to ascertain the opinion of the Hindu and Muslim leaders in India and then to prepare a report on the future constitution of India. However, when John Simon reached in India, the Indians had already decided to boycott the Simon Commission. All Indian National Congress flatly refused to cooperate with Mr. Simon and announced boycott of the Simon Commission. The opinion in India had been created that the British wanted to prolong their rule in India, and it was true. According to Ishtiaq Hussain Qureshi's struggle for Pakistan, according to Khalid bin Said, the formative phase, and many other scholars of India and Pakistan, they believed that the conservative party wanted to prolong their colonial rule in India, and they were afraid of Labour Party's manifesto that might give freedom to India. And to avoid that sort of freedom from India or any enactment regarding the freedom of India, the Conservative Party wanted to make a constitutional arrangement before the elections to be held in England. Thus, this commission reached in India. But when it reached to India, it was welcomed by the Indian people chanting the slogan, "Simon, go back, Simon, go back." So Congress had boycotted it. The Muslim League split into two major groups. Kolkata group, led by Jinnah and known as Jinnah group, decided to boycott the British Simon Commission, and they did not cooperate. They followed in the footsteps of Congress. Second group emerged under the leadership of Mia Mohammad Shafi, and they also decided to cooperate with the British Simon Commission. This group was also known as Lahore Group. Mia Shafi of Lahore Group announced that cooperation to Simon Commission might bring better concession for the Muslim community in India. So this is evident in the history that communalism in India was on its peak during this time. And Congress and Muslim League, Jinnah group were on one side and Mia Shafi group was on another side. British wanted to cash this communalism, but Congress and League, Jinnah group, did not give them much room. Simon Commission came here, he met with the leadership, but he did not find any positive response from them. Therefore, in the history, the Simon Commission failed, and it could not suggest its report on the basis of the recommendations of the majority of Indian leadership. Simon Commission report published in 1930. Before we take the review of the events which happened from 1927 to 1930, it seems imperative to conclude this topic. So in 1930, the report published, and its major points were: India could be given dominion status. Congress had rejected it. Congress wanted immediate self-rule. It recommended a joint electorate. So it displeased Muslim League because that was against the right of separate electorate that was granted to Muslim and other community of India in 1929. Then it suggested federal form of government. So Indians were not agreed to that. So Simon Commission failed, its report published in 1930. However, Simon Commission also recommended that the Indian leadership had divided and they could not reach on any consensus. Simon Commission recommended for a round table conference. That would be the topic in the last of this lecture. As far as concerns the major questions about Simon Commission, so that may be why was it sent to India? Answer already have been given. Was it a success? No, it failed. it prepared its report based on its own observations and the ascertain, and then it ascertained the opinions of the Indian leadership to whom it met. So when the Simon Commission returned to England and it still didn't produce the report, then Lord Birkenhead made a speech in the Parliament as a minister or secretary for Indian Affairs. The historians reveal that Lord Birkenhead challenged the Indian that they could not reach on any political agreement because their opinion had bifurcated. So if they wanted to create their own recommendation, they could send us the reports. So this was taken as a challenge by All Indian National Congress. All Indian National Congress organized an all-party conference in Madras in 1927. During this all-parties conference, All Indian National Congress, All Indian Muslim League, Hindu Mahasabha, Sikh Central League and other small political parties, they joined the conference, and in this conference they concluded that a constitutional committee must be set up, and that committee, known as Nehru Committee in the history, this Nehru Committee was set up under the leadership of Motilal Nehru. The important members of this committee was N.M. Joshi, Pradhan, Mangal Singh, Shoaib Qureshi, Sir Ali Imam, and the main task of the committee was to prepare a draft of the future constitution of India. This committee presented its report that was approved by the Executive Council of Congress on 20th August 1928 and it published. In the history of India, the report of Motilal Nehru's committee is known as Nehru Report. The significant feature of the Nehru Report were immediate dominion status of India, but it would remain part of Great Britain and would accept the monarch of England as the head of the state. This committee also suggested federation with the two houses legislative assembly, two chamber legislative assembly, upper house and the lower house. However, Nehru report rejected the right of separate electorate and suggested to implement the joint electorate. It also recommended for the elimination of one-third representation for the Muslims, the protection of the minorities through a reservation of system was very important and it was rejected. Adult franchise, one man, one vote. Gandhi also supported this resolution and he suggested that Nehru Report is the final document as a final and future constitution of India. He also gave a deadline to the British government that Nehru Report would be accepted as the future constitution of India by 30th December 1929. If this was rejected, then he would launch the non-cooperation movement again. Congress became adamant for the acceptance of Nehru Report and its implementation. Qaid Azam Muhammad Ali Jinnah suggested three amendments with a condition: if his three amendments on behalf of the Muslim League are accepted, then Muslim League would accept the Nehru report. He proposed equal representation in Bengal and Punjab because they were the majority provinces of Muslim community, 50-50%. He suggested then one-third representation for Muslims and equal provincial autonomy to all the provinces. He offered Congress, if his three recommendations are accepted, Muslim League would continue to cooperate with Congress and Nehru report might be accepted. However, Congress rejected the proposal of three proposals of Jinnah, and Gandhi remained adamant and stubbornly demanded the implementation of the Nehru report. The reaction of the Muslim leaders was furiously came forth. Iqbal rejected it. Maulana Muhammad Ali Johar called it a sneer for Muslim community. Chaudhry Khuliqo Zuman rejected it. Jinnah had already presented his three recommendations. They were rejected. So after the rejection of the Nehru report, the situation of the Hindu-Muslim relationships became further engulfed, and both communities were standing apart. The gulf between the Hindus and the Muslims had reached on its peak. To bridge this gap and to bring two communities closer to each other, Mr. Jinnah made another effort. The effort of Mr. Jinnah is known in the history of India as the 14 points of Mr. Jinnah. After the rejection of the Congress Nehru report, Mr. Jinnah again made an effort to bridge the gap between the Hindus and the Muslims. He presented his 14 points to the government of India. He put it before the people of India and Muslims particularly, and offered it to the Congress if their 14 points are accepted. Then the Muslims would continue cooperation with Congress and Nehru report could be amended and it may be implemented as the future constitution of India. I am not here to enumerate all the 14 points of Jinnah. However, it's important to take an account on the importance of the 14 points. Point 1. What did he present it? Mr. Jinnah presented 14 points to the Congress and the British, as well as both communities, Hindus and Muslims respectively, to make clear the fears Muslims had in their minds, and they wanted constitutional guarantees for the protection of the constitutional rights of the Muslims. The 14 points of Mr. Jinnah revolves around three important underpinnings. Number one, one-third representation. Number two, the equal provincial autonomy for the Muslims, and the rights of the minorities, exclusively the Muslims, must be protected in the constitution. Their language, their religion, their culture, their socio-political and economic rights. So the 14 points of Mr. Jinnah are important in the history because of their fear the Muslim had in their minds, and Jinnah reflected the minds of the Muslims. Unfortunately, Congress failed to read the minds of the Muslims, and these 14 points were rejected. The rejection of the 14 points disappointed Mr. Jinnah, who was a staunch protagonist of Hindu-Muslim unity. We find in history, after the rejection of his 14 points, he first time uttered a sentence, quote, "This is parting our ways," unquote. This sentence, "the parting of ways," means he sent the message to the British that your policy of divide and rule had succeeded. And he also sent the message to Congress that I had always been making efforts for bridging the gap between two communities of Hindus and Muslims, which are the largest community. And their unity could bring the freedom earlier to India, but your stubbornness, Mr. Gandhi, would finish this effort. It will prove as a futile exercise and Hindu-Muslim unity might come to an end. But Gandhi did not understand and failed to respond positively. After the rejection of these 14 points, Mr. Gandhi made a speech in the session of All India National Congress, and he blamed the British that they had failed to accept the demands and the Nehru report. So therefore, it's the right of the Congress to launch a non-cooperation. So Mr. Gandhi launched his non-cooperation on the 12th March 1930 from his ashram, and he called it Satyagraha. This started from his ashram and ended at Dandi. This is a long march, which is known as Salt March in the history of India, played a very important role to create another non-cooperation movement within India. The British government and the Indian British Viceroy responded quickly. Mr. Gandhi and others who were the part of this Salt March, they were arrested and put into prison. When Gandhi was put into prison and non-cooperation was going on, two other events happened in India. Ramsay MacDonald decided to hold round table conference in England. As already we have discussed, that Simon Commission report published in 1930 and the recommendations contained one recommendation about a round table conference where all parties of India must participate and suggest and reach on some conclusion. So round table conferences began in India. All Indian political parties, including All Indian National Congress, All Indian National, All Indian Muslim League, Hindu Mahasabha, Central Sikh League, and others, they were invited. Princely states rulers were also invited to be there. So roundtable conferences started in November 1930. When this conference started, Gandhi was in prison, and Congress refused to attend the conference and boycotted it. They decided to boycott and demanded self-rule. It's a very interesting piece of history. The political spokesman of Congress, Hindu Mahasabha, led by Madan Mohan Malviya and others, they reached into the conference. So Hindu community was represented by Hindu Mahasabha, and Gandhi was playing double game, according to the Pakistani historian's viewpoint. That Gandhi was playing double game. He wanted to send the message of the British Prime Minister Ramsay MacDonald and his government that Congress was the largest stakeholder, and without the attendance of Congress in the conference, it could not become a fruitful event. And he also exerted pressure upon the British government to come to the terms and reference of All India National Congress. All India Muslim League attended the conference. The leaders who attended the conference, Mr. Jinnah, and then Maulana Muhammad Ali Johar, Begum Sir Shah Nawaz, Aga Khan, and some others, they attended it. During this first roundtable conferences, the subcommittees for the rights of the minorities were constituted, and they presented the reports on the rights of the minorities. Qaid-e-Azam was one of the members. During this conference, the most important speech in the first session of the All Indian, and the all parties roundtable conference was made by Maulana Muhammad Ali Johar. Johar was ill at that time. Despite his illness, he went to England, he attended the conference and made his very important speech. His words are still remembered in the history as a freedom fighter. He said, "I had come to England to win the freedom of my country from shopkeepers." Then he explained at length about the role of All Indian National Congress, Muslim League and the British and their policies. So he made the case of the Muslims very effectively and freedom of India very effectively. Unfortunately, in January, he died, January 1931, and British government arranged to bury him in Yerushalayim, where he is known as Mujahid-e-Hindi, and still his grave is there. This first roundtable conference was being held in England, London, when All India Muslim League held its annual session in Allahabad. So Allahabad address in the of Allama Iqbal is another important event in the history of India. During this period, when a political event of all parties conference in the form of roundtable conference, first session going on in India, in England, the Muslim League held its session in Allahabad. Its session was presided over by the philosopher of East, Allama Iqbal, and the leader of All India Muslim League. Before I mention about his concept of a separate Muslim homeland, I would like to make it clear to my students and the viewers that three Muslim nationalist leaders, Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan, Allama Iqbal and Mr. Jinnah, they were supporter of Hindu-Muslim unity. They always made efforts for the unity of Hindu and Muslim so that pressure could be exerted upon the foreign rulers and freedom could be won. But some events happened in India that changed the mind of these three Muslim leaders. Sir Syed Ahmad Khan changed his mind in 1867 after Urdu-Hindi controversy. And he gave up his stance that India is a bride with two beautiful eyes of Hindus and Muslims. He made it clear to the commissioner of Benares that divide and rule policy had created the divide and a nation, Muslims, had been deprived of their language. So he's known as the pioneer of two nation theory by the Pakistani scholars. Jinnah was also the supporter of the Hindu-Muslim unity. He played a great role for Lucknow Pact, the first and the last pact between the Congress and the Muslim League, having dual membership of Congress and Muslim League. Jinnah played a very important role. He won the title of Hindu-Muslim, ambassador of Hindu-Muslim unity. But he was forced to utter the sentence, the parting of ways, in 1929-30. He broached the case of Muslims in round table conference. Iqbal was the poet of India. He was supporter of United India. His famous poem, Sare Jahan Se Achcha Hindustan Hamara, India is the most beautiful country in the world. He surrendered this opinion in Allahabad, and he gave a very comprehensive speech which is known as Allahabad Address. We students of history divide as Allahabad Address into three parts. First is, he elaborated that Islam and Hinduism are two different religions and different philosophies. They couldn't be same. He elaborated at length that the democratic system practiced in England is viable for the British because they belong to same nation, same religion, same culture, used to speak same language. So their two-party system is very efficiently working. He suggested in India, the democracy implemented in India following the model of Great Britain would be a disaster because here lived two different major communities. One is the Hindus and second is the Muslims. Therefore, he rejected that democratic system in his Allahabad address. He did not reject democracy as some right-wing historians said that they put forth some sort of arguments on the based of his few couplets that he was against democracy. Iqbal was not against the democracy. Iqbal declared the first parliament of Turkey as a form of ijtihad and modern democracy in his sixth lecture in his book The Reconstruction of Religious Thoughts in Islam. So Iqbal rejected the form of democracy being implemented in England could not viable and practicable in India because Indians are divided into two nations, Hindus and Muslims. Second, he had presented the facts indirectly, the divide and rule policy of Britain further divided them. So in the last part of his Allahabad address, Jinnah suggested I could foresee the Northwest Indian, where the Muslims were in majority, Punjab, Northwestern Frontier Province, KPK, now known as KPK, Balochistan and Sindh, could be implemented, could be amalgamated and form an independent Muslim state or they could remain within the dominion status of India, would win the autonomous status. So is this idea of a separate homeland for Muslims where they were in majority is recognized in history as the idea of Pakistan, which Iqbal floated without naming Pakistan. He only floated the idea of a separate homeland. So he suggested that the northwestern Muslim majority regions, Punjab, Sindh, Balochistan, and KPK, could be amalgamated and could become an independent Muslim country, or they might become a dominion status state. This is very important to note for the students of the history. He did not include Bengal in it. Even in 1940 Pakistan resolution, Bengal was not part of the demand. Hussain Shaheed Fauz Sohrawardi floated the idea of including Bengal as a part of Pakistan in 1947 Pakistan Convention. 1946 Pakistan Convention in April 1946. Allahabad Address is very important in the history of Pakistan and in India. Iqbal floated the idea of a separate homeland as a leading Muslim leader of the Muslim League first time from the platform of Muslim League. It was not the demand of Muslim League. It was the idea of a separate Muslim state by a Muslim leader. Though it was floated by a single personality, by a personality or the major towering leader of Muslim League. However, it was a message to the British government, it was a message to the Congress, it was a message to the leaders of the Muslim League who were engaged in all parties round table conference. So the British could understand that this message actually is very, very important, because the communal gulf had bridged, had been widened and couldn't be bridged. Let's come back to round table conference. The first round table conference remained confined to the rights of the majorities, and the British government and Ramsay MacDonald note down the points. The second round table conference held in 1932. This time the Viceroy of India, Lord Irwin, had taken over. Winston Churchill opposed any negotiation with Gandhi as an opposition leader, but Irwin very strictly dealt with the non-cooperation movement, and he decided to hold talks to bring Gandhi on some reconciliation. So a pact was signed between Mr. Mohanchand Karamdas Gandhi and Irwin, that is known in the history as Lord Irwin Pact. Under this Lord Irwin Pact, three major points were agreed between the British government of India and Gandhi and Congress. Congress would participate in the round table conference. To the response of this gesture, all the cases against Congress leadership would be withdrawn, and Gandhi would be released from the prison. So Lord Irwin played a master stroke in the history of India. Gandhi was released. Congress leadership was released from prisons. Cases were withdrawn. Second roundtable conference commenced. Gandhi came there as a sole representative of the Hindu community in this conference. My dear students and viewers, the role of Gandhi is viewed with two different angles. Congress historians believe that Gandhi actually appeared as a sole representative to deal with the British on behalf of the Congress. And Gandhi had no power to make any decision on behalf of the Congress because he was asked to represent Congress, note the points and bring back to the Executive Council of the Congress for final decision. And they would approve it off or reject it. The Muslim historians view it with a different viewpoint. They believed that Gandhi came there to sabotage the Second Roundtable Conference. They argued that when the rights of the Muslims were demanded from Congress, Gandhi presented the excuse that he had no power, he had no membership in the Congress, he had been honored to represent Hindu community in Congress in the roundtable conference. So all the points are noted and would be presented to the Congress that would decide about it. So the role of the Congress was very negative in this conference and it was sabotaged. It could not produce any result. However, Ramsay MacDonald and Government of India, they ascertained and inferred some decisions. So in August 1932, the Prime Minister of England, Ramsay MacDonald, presented the communal award. Under this communal award, the separate electorate was expanded to all the communities, even the four different Hindu caste, Brahmins, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas and Shudras. It was very important task, very important point to note that was expanded to all the Hindu caste systems as well as Sikh and Muslims, Anglo-Indians. They also promised to award future constitution on the basis of self-rule and dominion status. Rights of the minorities were granted. Gandhi got infuriated on the decision of expansion of separate electorate, and he was not satisfied with the self-rule. So when in 1930 the third roundtable conference held, Gandhi decided to go on hunger strike called in Indian Hindi Maran Bharth. So Gandhi went on to Maran Bharth or hunger strike. He demanded that the British government must withdraw the right of self-electorate for four Hindu castes. Then a group of the princes, they formed a delegation and went to the residence of Shudra leader in Pune, where they signed an agreement with the leader of the Shudras, Umbedkar, and Gandhi, known as Pune Pact. Under this Pune Pact, he withdrew the right of self-electorate and demanded the British that it must not be implemented in next constitution. Then Gandhi finished its Maran Bharata's hunger strike. Third roundtable conference was not attended by the Muslim leader. Jinnah remained absent and it failed. The last part of this lecture is that roundtable conferences consisted on three important sessions. Session 1, 1931 to 31. Session 2, December 31 to 32, and the last session held in England in 1930. These roundtable conferences thoroughly observed and discussed the issues of the Hindu-Muslim communal problems. But second roundtable conference was expected to produce some result, but Gandhi made it a failure. However, MacDonald Communal Award actually led towards 1935 India Act. We would review 1935 India Act, and the Congress ministries came into power under 1937 provincial elections in our part 2 of this lecture. Today I sum up this lecture. Let's have the important questions. Question number 1. Why was Simon Commission sent to India? Recapitulation of this question and topic of Simon Commission. Simon Commission was sent to India to review the situation of India, aiming at ascertaining the opinion of Indians and prepare the draft for the future constitution. Second important question about Simon Commission. Why did it fail? It failed because Congress and liberals of the League did not cooperate with him. Only Mia Shafi group cooperated, that had no importance. So Simon Commission failed. Opposed by all Indians except the leaguers of Shafi group, and it prepared its report based on its own observation, published in 1930, gave some suggestions which were rejected by Muslim League and Congress majority. Next question. Why did Congress establish Nehru Committee and what were its output? Was it a success or failure? Nehru Committee was established to the response of the challenge of Lord Birkenhead, Secretary for State of India. It was headed by Motilal Nehru and other Muslim and Hindu leaders. So when it presented its report, Ali Imam did not attended it. Shoaib Qureshi wrote contradictory note on the points of League, on the points of Nehru report. Qaid-e Azam proposed three amendments, they were rejected, and then Qaid-e Azam presented his 14 points, they were rejected as a chain reaction of Congress. So this report could not become a success, but Congress remained adamant to implement it at the future constitution that further increased the division of opinion between Hindus and Muslims, and Jinnah had to say the parting of ways. So this report rejected by Muslims, but Congress wanted to make it Constitution of India. In the result, Gandhi threatened for non-cooperation and salt march began, and as the 12 or struck in the midnight of the 30th December 1929, Nehru took out a procession from Lahore and Gandhi started long march, salt march on 30th March 1930. Non-cooperation was further started in India. To overcome this problem, Government of India organized roundtable conferences. Muslim League participated, Hindu Mahasabha participated, Allahabad address was given. So why was roundtable conferences held is an important question. Was it a success or failure? It was partially successful, but it failed due to the attitude of Mr. Gandhi. And Allahabad address was a successful session of Muslim League. Since its creation, first time a Muslim leader gave the idea of a separate homeland, and that was accepted by the Muslims, and it became very popular amongst them. So League sent the message that we are not agreed to reach on any conclusion without the guarantee of their rights, even at the cost of separate homeland. And Congress remained adamant for united India and self-rule. Dear viewers, if you like my lecture that I prepare for you only, I request for the subscription of my channel. And it's my right. You must subscribe Dr. Nasir Hussain for conveying it to all Pakistani students for benefiting. It's my mission of life to give them impartial analysis of the history of Pakistan and to make them able to prepare their subject of Pakistan affairs and Pakistan studies paper 1 of IGCSE and GCE without attending any academy and spending money. Thank you.